morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
Lots of tiny, shiny, wobbly calves drying on the ground around here these days, and I'd say the area is well underway with calving. And this week, another wild cow story about how it goes when you're trying to treat her calf from Baxter Black.
The cow continued to force her way in as Jim dangled out the other side.
And we call them analysts. Sometimes we even call them experts. I'm not sure why, but often they say one thing one time, and then what they say is subject to change. And the Rangeland News has an update on changing prediction.
Demand for beef seems to be strong, which also keeps prices from falling as far and as fast as had been expected earlier this year.
The distinguished cowboy poet Dave Longworth shared some good ones on our virtual cowboy concert recently, and I thought I'd bring one back that he did and haze it into the cowboy poetry spotlight.
Why, me and that horse ain't got a divorce, I don't know. Boy, I surely can pick him.
And on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear horse training file, sometimes when you can't get it done with a horse, the best thing you can do is walk away. Got an example of how that works today, and chuck wagon racing legend Rick Fraser is back with some more great stories about other legends of the sport.
He didn't have a dime, but Doris had 35 cents, and they get a mile or something from the fairgrounds, they run out of gas.
Great story coming up about Orville Strandquist and a song from his grandson. And the music is all about horses and cowboys, and what better way to start out than this one from Wiley in the Wild West.
The hooves of the horses, witching and sweet, is the music earth steals from iron-shod feet. No whisper of lover, no trilling of bird, can stir me as hooves of the horses have stirred. They spurn disappointment, they trample despair, and drown with their drum beats the challenge of care. With scarlet and silk for their banners above, they're swifter than fortune, sweeter than love. Of the nighttime, I hear them go by. Horses of memory thundering through, flashing white fetlocks all wet with the dew. When you lay me to slumber, no spot you can choose, but will ring to the rhythm of galloping shoes. And under the daisies, no grave be so deep for the hooves of the horses to sound in my sleep. For the hooves of the horses to sound in my sleep.
Ah, Ray Doyle playing that beautiful baritone guitar on that one. Well, you know, rodeos, horse shows, and live music are big victims of the shutdown of the last 12 months. And by the way, on the Rangeland News today, we'll update you on some of the events that are planning to proceed and some that are not. Meanwhile, Rick Fraser is back this week, and boy, hey, Rick, these have been tough times.
Yeah, well, we're hoping these days that with everything that's going on that there'll still be chuck wagon racing.
Well, yeah.
You know, it financially, it's pretty tough right now when you haven't had any income for 2 years. And it's about, you know, $25,000 to $30,000 a winter to feed all your horses and take care of them. You know, so it's quite a thing.
Yeah, you know, Rick, this is, you know, my heart just goes out to everybody in that industry, you know, the stock contractors, my gosh, you know, what they've got invested and what they're doing for all the Bronx and the Bulls and the other stock they've got, and I don't know if the general public has any idea, you know, what it takes for these guys to hang on like they are.
It's pretty difficult right now. It really is. I feel for them guys, and, you know, and this is a selfish note that I'm about to say, but I am so grateful that we decided to sell out 2 years ago, or we'd be looking at, you know, 35 head of horses out the window as well, wondering what we're going to do with them.
Right. I was going to ask you about that. Since your retirement in 2018, you and Sue have kept busy. Tell me a little bit about some of the things you've been doing since then.
Well, actually, you know, it's interesting you should say that. When we sold out and then we come home, we'd sold our vacuum trucks a couple of years before that, but we realized, you know, we had no plan B. We never even gave it a thought. And then we got home and we looked at each other, and now what? We still got to have an income of some kind, and now we're actually working online, generating our income off of the computer. You know, we literally went from horse and buggy to the online world. It's been quite a learning curve for me.
Boy, you know, that's a big, steep change, man, oh man.
It is, yeah.
Did you have much to do with computers and technology before?
I couldn't even turn one on. So there was a, it was very fortunate. The town here had a computer course, and it was right from turning it on all the way, and they taught you a whole bunch of stuff. And the people did a really great job of it. And so we took that course, and it helped a lot.
Well, we'll get more details on what Rick and Sue are doing since Rick's retirement, and there's another song that's a pretty good fit when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Our mission is to help our clients sell their equipment in the most effective way possible. People who are looking at our auction, they are literally all over North America. Once we take somebody through a process from start to finish, the first time, they get it. You know, it's very simple. It's more simple than they think.
Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. After a great career in the high-speed world of chuck wagon racing, Rick Fraser retired in 2018, and looking back on it, his timing worked out pretty well. But when one aspect of your life changes to another, there's a lot of things to consider, and Rick is still on the line from Wetaskiwin.
So tell me a little more about your online business.
Well, what it is it's called attraction marketing. And this is the part that when we first started up, I had a really difficult time wrapping my head around. We're not selling anything. We're not buying a bunch of junk to hope your family and friends come over to buy. That's not it at all.
Like how to narrow down your focus and come closer to your target rather than reaching hundreds of thousands of people that have no interest in what you're doing.
We advertise in Canada and Ireland right now.
Really?
Because on the internet, the whole world's your marketplace. Yeah, there's, it's not like you're running an ad in the newspaper. And you got Facebook, you got YouTube, LinkedIn, Google. there's all kinds of platforms to be to advertise on. Yes, and they know. They know more about us than we know about us. And I'm not talking about what we're doing. I'm talking about like Facebook and all them. They gather all this information about us, and I don't really understand how they do it, but I know they do it.
That's a little scary sometimes. Like, how did they know I wanted to see this, or how did they, you know? It's an incredible world. A lot of the old cowboy neighbors of mine and old ranchers kind of scoff at all of this, and I'm a little different, I guess, that way, because I'm just fascinated by the technology and by the potential and by the opportunities and everything, you know. And the deeper I get into it, the more fascinated I am with it.
Well, the thing is, when you go to advertise, whatever it is, the whole world's your marketplace. It's just not your local town anymore. Like when you have a restaurant, you have this very small group of people that you're drawing from. When you're working online, you have the whole planet to draw from.
Yeah, and the big challenge is to somehow be able to focus on that big global universe that is interested in what you're doing, isn't it? Track down those places. Fascinating.
Yeah.
We'll get further into this shortly, and you know, when you've always had horses in your life, I think for most of us, that's something we would not want to lose. And Rick will talk about that as well, but right now, here's Mike Beck.
Let me tell you about the horses in my stream. The youngest one's a 4-year-old, the oldest 17. The paint and roan and buckskin, they're all scattered in between. There's some to make you cuss, some sing. Now the top horse boss, that's the horse for you. He loads and stands and ground ties, he'll head and heel them too. He's getting on, but there still ain't a thing that he can't do. And you'll like him, boss. He's tall and strong and true. Horses in my string, they ain't been perfect, but they're fine. And I've treated every one of them just like they were mine. I know I'll miss them all just like my friends here when I'm gone. But the time is near for me to move along. Let me tell you about that paint horse that I ride. A month ago that mare, she up and kicked me in the side. When you're tied to something wild, she will not be denied. I'd pass her to some fast rope like old Clyde. But the buckskin and the roan I'd give to Bert. He's the only one can handle them without him getting hurt. They're both as mean as rattlesnakes, and they'll paw you in the dirt. When it comes to chows and boss, they'll work. The horses in my string, they ain't been perfect, but they're fine. I've treated every one of them just like they were mine. I know I'll miss them all just like my friends here when I'm gone. But the time is near for me to move along. Let me tell you about that last horse in my string. That 4-year-old's a bronco, yet his belly's full of spring. He just might make the best cow horse this ranch has ever seen. And I trust him to no one but old Jean. Have I told you about my girl in Tennessee? Her folks, they own a racehorse ranch. They're trusting it to me. Oh, she's as pretty as a sunrise boss. She's the only thing could make me leave the horses in my string. Horses in my string, they ain't been perfect, but they're fine. I've treated every one of them just like they were mine. I know I'll miss them all just like my friends here when I'm gone. But the time is near for me to move along. I know I'll miss them all just like my friends here when I'm gone. The time has come for me to move along. Take care of the horses in my string.
Well, back when I was riding my young horse Dandy around the infield interviewing chuck wagon drivers and outriders, kind of like what Billy Melville does now on the chuck wagon TV broadcast, I met a wiry, personable outrider and driver who I actually think was Billy's grandfather. His name, Orville Strandquist. He was one of the few men who could drive two wagons, outride every heat he wasn't driving in at every race, and at a time when chuck wagon competitors had to enter at least one rodeo event, Orville participated in bull riding, steer decorating, standing Roman races, wild horse races, and wild cow milking. He was a two-time Canadian and Calgary Stampede wild horse race champ, and the 1958 Canadian and Calgary Stampede wild cow milking champion, and a record three-time Cheyenne Frontier Days wild horse champion. And Rick Fraser, you're pretty familiar with Orville Strandquist, and it just seemed like he never aged.
And he wild horse raced till he was 65.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
Like, this guy was a hand, like, big time.
Yeah.
In the 50s, he didn't have a truck to haul his horses. And this is a funny story, because I got it out of his book. So he hired his neighbor to haul the horses to High River from Stettler in the spring for the chuck wagon races. And Doris, his wife, she milked cows and that and sold cream, and she'd saved up all winter. She saved up for this trip. She had 35 cents. And they get in the station wagon and they're headed the High River. And now Orville's not worried at all, because Orville, he entered every event. And this guy was a hand. So he would always get checks. So he wasn't worried about money. He didn't have a dime, but Doris had 35 cents. And they get a mile or something from the fairgrounds. They run out of gas. And this farmer charged him 25 cents for a gallon of gas. You know, it would be like $20 for a liter of gas.
Yeah, holy. He's got 10 cents left.
Yeah. They get to High River, and they get the horses unloaded, and they go to sleep, get up in the morning, and there's 8 inches of snow on the ground. It snowed out. They had, it was canceled. And Orville said, I'm sitting on the wagon trailer wondering how am I going to get everything home. And Hank Willard, one of the great chuck wagon drivers of the time, come jogging over to Orville and said, "Here's $100, Orville. I forgot to pay you for outriding in Calgary last year." Smiled, and he said, "I gassed the trucks up, and the car up, went downtown, and had this big feast." And
oh my gosh!
And he said, "My neighbor always thought chuck wagon guys had lots of money, but because of that."
Well, as I mentioned, I got a pretty good song from Orville's grandson, Billy Melville, coming up next. Baxter Black, though, and a pretty good calving wreck when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Howdy, friends. This is Baxter Black on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan, and I'll be right back after this with a little peek at One Leg Up.
Your land is a legacy, a challenge from those who tended it before you. to build on their foundations. At Corteva Agriscience, we understand what it means to be the stewards of a legacy. We embrace the challenge of building on the foundation of Dow AgroSciences to maintain your trust, to bring new solutions, to help you care for your land. See how we can help build your legacy at rangeandpasture.com.
And for our Canadian listeners, just check Corteva.ca, the Canadian website.
Jess's friend Jim was in the Army and wounded in action, a serious leg wound that resulted in a Purple Heart and a pension. He recovered and came back to the plains of Colorado and got a job on a drilling rig. Things went well until he caught his bad leg in the Kelly and had to have it amputated. Not only did he lose his leg, but he lost his pension. Well, sometime down the road, he found himself with a wooden leg and a bunch of mother cows. Last calving season, he was out checking for newborns. He spotted one whose mama was hovering over him like a stage mother. Well, Jim intended to tag and vaccinate the calf. Being a practitioner of the cowboy mentality, he put on his thinking cap, drove up beside the calf, and opened the passenger door. Slick as a pickpocket, Jim leaned out the door and snagged the calf. He dragged it in, but before he could shut the door, Mama Cow stuck her head in and her front feet. She started crawling aboard, bawling at the top of her cow lungs. Jim dove to the left, pushed open the door, and dived. His wooden leg caught between the high-low four-wheel drive and the four-on-the-floor stick shift. It wouldn't budge. The cow continued to force her way in as Jim dangled out the other side. Straightening his thinking cap, he undid his buckle and fly and managed to strip to the waist. You can strip to the waist from either end, by the way. To get free, leaving his pants and enclosed prosthesis still in the cab. He hit the ground and slithered up under the pickup. He lay there panting pantless for 5 minutes waiting for the cow to leave. She stayed with the calf. He figured if he could pull the calf out of the pickup, the cow would follow. He reached his arm up from his supine position and palpated periscopically like an octopus exploring a doghouse from under the porch. Grasping a small foot, he managed to extract the calf and the cow crashed out behind it. After they had disengaged a safe distance, Jim slid, drug, and hopped back behind the wheel, unwound his pants and leg from the gears, and headed back to the house, all the time hoping none of the neighbors would show up. I commented to Jess that Jim was quite resourceful. Yep, he said, he don't do bad for a guy with one foot in the grave. This is Baxter Black on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan, brought to you by Corteva Agriscience.
Not much can raise your stress level more than a tractor breakdown when you need it most. We've all spent hours on the phone and driving around trying to find the right parts, and that's no fun when you're missing something you need to finish the job. Here's a better way. Just go to bctractorparts.com. That's where you can find about any part for any mega tractor. If you're restoring a vintage tractor or just keeping up the maintenance on the ones you're using, you can have the parts you need in a short time. And you know what? There's some great pictures of tractor restoration projects and much more right there at bctractorparts.com. What? Oh, you don't have internet? Well, try calling Mark at 250-395-0960. Just ahead of the rangeland news, Ed Brown usually rides and does ranch work all summer in Manitoba. Then when the snow comes, he packs his bedroll and his guitar into his little Toyota and drives all the way down through the rangeland of the Southwest right to Mexico, singing his songs along the way for anybody who'll listen. But this winter, he's been feeding cows in the snow and hopefully writing more great songs like this one.
He rides a horse called Lonesome and leads one called Days Gone By. He doesn't quite know just how to let go, so he rides beneath a dark, cloudy sky. A future more bright was the promise, but he's been thinking that somebody lied. He didn't need the change, he liked riding the range, but today he's got no place to hide. God's home to the cowboy, and under its skies he did roam. There were plenty of uses for humpback cayuses, and plenty of loops to be thrown. With a campfire consuming the darkness, and a bed right there by its side. His diamonds were hitches, his friends were his riches, but today he's got no place to hide. Now you don't see much of the chuck wagon, or of the old hula hand. Diamonds are things found in fancy gold rings, and it's hard to know just where you stand. The highways and fences now travel where the old buckaroo to ride. Plans have been laid, and the price has been paid, and the real cowboy's got no place to
of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
Looking at the top of page one, it says cattle producers have often pondered on the price paid for calves and yearlings and the retail price of beef at the meat counter on the other end. Well, a while ago, those retail prices were expected to drop by now, but that doesn't seem to be happening, and Gary Crawford has more.
After a 3.5% increase in grocery store food prices this past year, we could see another average hike this year of between 1 and 2%. Beef prices sort of led last year's food price increases at over 9.5%, but Agriculture Department economist Carolyn Chellis is expecting beef prices this year to drop a little bit from 1 to 2%, but that is less of a drop than her previous forecast. She says several factors are limiting beef price declines. First,
the winter storms, both in Texas and then some of the southern states.
Those limited the movement of cattle to market and slowed down meat processing plants. Another factor,
the price for soybeans and corn has been going way up in the past few months, and those are inputs that are used to feed cattle. So those prices are also driving up the ultimate cost of beef.
Plus, Chellis says the demand for beef seems to be strong, which also keeps prices from falling as far and as fast as had been expected earlier this year. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
USDA announced it will not finalize a plan put forth by the Trump administration to approve RFID tags as the official ear tag for the interstate movement of cattle, and the Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service will use the rulemaking process for future actions on the RFID tags. The agency first proposed making RFID tags the official identification method for cattle and bison back in April of 2019. But RCAF USA filed a lawsuit against the USDA alleging that the RFID mandate was unlawful, and within weeks, the agency withdrew its mandate. Well, early in October, two-time world champion saddle bronc rider Mel Hyland of Valley View, Alberta, underwent a massive heart attack while he was training young horses, and it was a long road to recovery, but on March 20th, he was back in the saddle for the first time since the attack. Saw a great picture of him on a good-looking horse, and it was so nice to see that big grin back on Mel's face. Ducks Unlimited at Canada has teamed up with McDonald's Canada and Cargill to support rancher-led work through a $5 million forage program. The program will return 125,000 acres of cropland to grass and pasture by 2025. McDonald's and Cargill are investing 1.25 million Canadian in the forage program over the next 5 years. Well, just got the news that the Heart of the Horse event, produced by Nikki Flundra, will take place at the Pincher Creek Outdoor Rodeo Grounds, located, of course, in southern Alberta, August the 2nd to the 8th. The number of seats available to the public isn't known yet, but they are working on it. And we just got word of the cancellation of the Williams Lake Stampede in June-July 2021. The directors have indicated that there's a possibility of a smaller-scale rodeo sometime later in the summer or fall. And the next regular cattle sale at the Kamloops Yards of the BC Livestock Co-op is April the 20th, regular sale in Williams Lake April 22nd. Then the crew moves up to Vanderhoof for the regular sale on the 23rd. Get all the information and watch the sales live at bclivestock.bc.ca. Meanwhile, our friends at the Innisfail Auction Market have regular cattle sales every Wednesday. I think everybody knows that. And a lot of special breeding stock sales are still going on, along with their pre-sort sales. Get all the information at InnisfailAuctionMarket.com, or you can give Danny, Mark, or Dwayne a call at 403-227-3166. I came across this word. By the way, this is the final item. Came across this word, paraprosodians. Paraprosodians. What they are figures of speech where the last part of a sentence or a phrase contains a surprise or an unexpected twist, like kind of like mixing metaphors. I'll give you a few examples. Where there's a will, I want to be in it. And the last thing I want to do is hurt you, but it's still on my list. And since light travels faster than sound, some people appear bright until you hear them talk. And in filling out an application where it says, in case of emergency, notify, I answered, a doctor. Or I used to be indecisive, but now I'm not so sure. Or I like this one. I'm supposed to respect my elders, I know, but it's getting harder and harder to find one now. Okay, there you have the Rangeland News. Coming up in the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, how sometimes just walking away from a horse you're trying to catch is the best thing to do. And more from Rick Fraser when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Our mission is to help our clients sell their equipment in the most effective way possible. People who are looking at our auction, they are literally all over North America. Once we take somebody through a process from start to finish, the first time, they get it. You know, it's very simple. It's more simple than they think.
Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. There's more of the visit with Rick Fraser still to come. And right now, here's a word from Lucky.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
Start thinking spring with help from Canada's largest Western store. That's right, spring stock is arriving at Irvine Tack and Western Wear. See what's new and start suiting up with the latest from the biggest names in the biz. Boulay, Ariat, Wrangler, Cinch, Huey, and more. Jeans, jackets, boots, shirts, hats, hoodies, it's all here at Irvine's, exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield, or shop online at irvines.ca.
Don't just wear it, live it. Irvine Tack and Western Wear.
Well, sometimes when you can't get it done, the best solution is to turn around and walk away. Now, a while back, I had an interesting challenge. There were two mares and a gelding in about a 15-acre pasture just over the hill from here. My assignment was to get the youngest gelding, and he was about 9 at that time, over to our place and try and get to the point where he can be caught, saddled, and ridden. Well, my buckskin mare, Lucky, is an immeasurable help with this kind of a job. So I rode her over there, and wouldn't you know it, she was coming into heat at her age, good grief. And the three horses in the pasture picked up the fragrance on the wind, and they came closer, so I just got off, and I dropped Lucky's reins on the ground. And I took a halter through the gate into the pasture, and it was only a matter of minutes before I was able to put my hands on the necks and faces of two of the three horses. But the one I wanted was very wary, and he did not want to be caught. But after a fairly short time, I was able to approach with the halter in plain view and eventually rub his forehead and face gently with my hand. I'd give him one gentle rub and then just turn and walk away before he decided to leave. Now, three or four of these rubs, and I could gently rub his neck on each side, but if I made any attempt to slide my right arm over his neck, he told me he was going to be gone. And if I showed any indication of trying to slip the halter on from his left side, he would have left immediately. He had become pretty good at avoiding being caught. But eventually, I was able to rub the right side of his neck with the halter shank and then turn and walk away before he left. And I gradually lengthened the time I spent rubbing his neck with the shank, alternating with turning and walking away. All the while, I could see he was slowly becoming more accepting of my touch and actually starting to like it. And before long, I was able to gently slide the halter shank over his neck from his right side. Now, if he'd pulled away when he felt the pressure, I would have to let him go. Worst thing I could have done would be to pull on him. He stood, however, and then I was able to move to his right side, and after a few more caresses of his neck, slip the halter on and do it up. And then I could see that he did have some yield to the halter. So I let him through the gate, climbed back on Lucky, ponied him over to our place, and now his lessons would begin. And if you stay tuned, I'll tell you what the big issue was and what works to fix it in the coming weeks. And for Urban Saddles and Western Wear, that's the Horse Training File. The horses at our place are looking pretty good, even though they're well up in years now, and we attribute a lot of that to a daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration. And you can find out all about it at hoffmanshorseproducts.com. The way the Canada Revenue Agency deals with ranchers and farmers has changed a lot in the last few years, and the financial decisions we make today can have a long-lasting impact on our bottom line far into the future. It really helps to have a trusted professional who really understands your situation to guide you with all your accounting requirements and your tax preparation. Having an accountant who knows the difference between a Hereford and a heifer, what a slick and backgrounding are, and that Alfalfa and Timothy are not just names from a storybook, really helps. Kathy McMillan of PMT Chartered Professional Accountants understands the intricacies of specialized programs like AgriStability and AgriInvest. She understands the demands on your time and can help you spend more time doing your job and less time dealing with endless piles of paperwork. See PMTAccountants.com or call toll-free 877-383-8081. Well, if you've ever watched the chuck wagon racing on national television, you've probably seen and heard the expert color commentary from Billy Melville. And you've probably read his column, Wheel to Wheel, in Canadian Cowboy Country magazine. Well, this is Billy from a CD he sent me back in 1994, when we were both a little bit younger.
This cowboy straps his leggings on and rosins up his rope to make the ride and save his pride. Takes lots of guts and hope. He bears down hard and holds on tight and then hollers for the gate. It's a heavy chore to make the score and ride that count of eight. This cowboy plays the country songs of Brooks and Strait and Black. The dream to be a star and play guitar is what keeps him coming back. The rundown bars on Saturday nights is the only life he knows. The smoke and the beer and year after year is how the life of a rambling man. Is it the one who goes the rodeo and rides those bulls and broncs? Is it the one who sings the country songs in the beat of honky-tonks? Is it the one who plants his crops in spring then harvests in the fall? greatest cowboy of them all. This cowboy fights the elements and the guys down at the bank. To make his pay, he works all day with little praise or thanks. With his sunburned neck and his calloused hands, there's no doubt he's the salt of the earth. His home is at hand, but he's a hell of a man, and we don't think enough of his worth. Well, this question's got me thinking, but my back's against the wall. I don't think I can pick just one man to be the greatest one of them all. One who never says die and is willing to try and gets up after every fall. Helps those in need and ain't a victim of greed. Is the greatest cowboy of all. Is it the one who goes to rodeo and rides those bulls and bronc? Is it the one who sings the country songs in the beat up? Is it the one who plants his crops in spring, then harvests in the fall? Tell me who's the greatest cowboy of them all. Tell me who's the greatest cowboy of them all.
And Billy Melville wrote that, too. Well, let's get back now to Rick Fraser. And Rick, we do have time for at least one more story.
In 1972, Dad, we get to the Calgary Stampede, and Dad needs an outriding horse, and he buys a, I don't know who he bought him from, but he buys a horse off the racetrack in Edmonton. The horse's name was Aim to Win. And they load this horse in the horse trailer, and they get down to the fairgrounds at Calgary just in time for the outriding horses to go over for the races that night. So they put a saddle on him, and they put a bridle on him, and they lead him over. Now, Hugh, this horse had never been out of a box stall in his life. He hadn't seen nothing other than the racetrack, you know, and these wagons are everywhere. And Richard Cosgrave's standing there, and I don't think Richard wouldn't have been that old, maybe 18, somewhere in there. And Mom hands the shank to Richard. He says, here's your new outriding horse. And Richard said his eyes were as big as saucers, and he was 2 feet off the ground. He was so excited and scared and everything. But Richard, Calgary was 9 days at the time, and Richard got that horse by the ninth day. He was a foolproof outriding horse.
My gosh.
That horse never caused a penalty.
Wow.
Not even. That's how good of a hand Richard Cosgrave was.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, it's kind of like, you know, our whole traditions of the West that used to be, you know, we were only one generation away from living on the land and the farm and the ranch and everything. But now, my goodness, the generations in the big cities have no concept of the way of life that a few of us are still privileged to live, you know, and make our living off the land with horses and cattle and spend hours sometimes in the saddle and that kind of stuff. They don't even believe that way of life exists, or don't.
You know, they're so far removed from the agriculture now. I think it might be less than three in 10 people still have agricultural roots. Yeah, it's a great culture that we have in this Western heritage life that we were, and I believe that we were fortunate enough and blessed enough to be in. Yeah.
Well, listen, Rick, it's just been a real pleasure to visit with you. And like I say, give my best to all our friends out there, Paul Kelke and anybody else that happens to come around, because we miss those folks so much since we're not traveling.
And I will. You know what? It was a thrill to talk to you today. It honestly is. Yeah, and I'm honored that you'd take the time to give me a call.
Rick, it was a real honor for me, that's for sure. Coming up is another classic song of the West, and yes, it's about wagons, and then Dave Longworth in the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. For this week's classic song of the West, we're going to take you back to 1952, not that long ago, for the theme of what was a pretty decent Western movie, The Sons of the Pioneers, and the theme from Wagons West.
Wagons West!
Wagons West!
Dusty wheels are going, cross mountains high, they keep rolling by, and the thunder echoes in the sky. 100 years have come and gone since 1849, but the ghostly wagons rolling west are ever brought to mind. Their rolling, rocking, creaking wheels were heard from shore to shore, and always in the hearts of men it lives forevermore. Rollin', 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 wagons west are rollin', out where winds are blowin', cross rivers and plains, through sand and through rain, rolls a mighty wagon train. Wagons west are rolling, dusty wheels are going, cross mountains high, they keep rolling by, and their thunder echoes in the sky. Stalwart men in buckskins, their women by their sides, the sun sets on their faces as they ride on westward ride. Wagons west are rolling, golden hills are glowing, for the pioneers down through the years have made this land our home. Rolling, 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 rolling.
1952, it would have been probably Tommy Lloyd and Dale making up the trio sound for the Sons of the Pioneers, and then, of course, Hugh and Carl Farr joining in on the cascading harmony. Well, the distinguished cowboy poet Dave Longworth is in the spotlight this week. Folks just love seeing and hearing him recite this on our virtual Kamloops Cowboy Festival show online.
Light sifting down through the gaps in the barn as the sun's cracking out a new day. And I get the feeling I'm late as I cruise through the gate, cause there stares the old Two Socks Bay. Now old Notcher, he's twitching like maybe he's fixing to see if I still got me some stickum. Why, me and that horse ain't got a divorce, I don't know. Boy, I surely can pick him. But he senses it too, morning and dew. Why bother in such pretty weather? Save it for snow and 20 below, and there's need to be warm in the leather. Now it's time to make tracks, so I strap on my keck, step aboard and screw down my hat. And through long shadows and haze and warm early rays, past corrals and down onto the flat. Splash across the stream, the colts are careening, the mares are alert but still munching. Then come curious steers, and even old Toro appears. Then there's the mamas and the babies a-bunching. And there ain't nothing that's half as cute as spring calves. Shiny coats and big eyes a-gazing. You know, maybe this place ain't so much in the big scheme as such, but it's mine. And to me, it's worth praising. Cause there's room here to spare, and it's in me to care. And there ain't nobody cussing and fussing. Just good, honest working keeps my old blood perking. It's a life I won't trade, not for nothing.
And those of you who know Dave will be aware that he has changed the name of that to Tammy's poem in honor of his late wife, Tammy, the wonderful lady that she was. And the virtual Kamloops Cowboy Festival with a great lineup of talent is still available and will be for good for viewing anytime on YouTube. Just go to our website, u-mclennan.com, for the links. And that's where you get the links to the YouTube version of every Spirit of the West episode as well. And thank you so much for riding along this week. I sure hope you can join us next week right here at the same time. And as always, thanks to our great support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.